can apply a projector hypocoracker to the equation, I don't think you want to see that projector. So I'll just take my word. And essentially what you see is what you call the half Klein-Gordon type equation with a cubic non-linearity. And obviously it's a Klein-Gordon equation, so the symbol is what you expect to get. Now I'm going to normalize the mass to 1. Now the original problem, the cubic Dirac equation, whichever we want to think about it, is critical in H n minus 1 over 2. So in three dimensions, Escobar Ortega from the local world coordinates for small data, subcritical, Mascarana and Shirozawa from global world coordinates for subcritical data, and then they also did global world coordinates for small radial data in the critical space, and last year with Sebastian we got global world coordinates for general small data in the critical space. Now in two dimensions, the problem is particularly delicate, I hope you explain why, but there were no global in time results. So they have proved local world coordinates for the two-dimensional problem with small data just in the subcritical space. And now very recently, in the massless case, so if you take the mass to be equal to zero, that is equal, so when I'm going to say the massless case, that's n equals zero, the massive case is m positive. So in the case n equals zero, Bonavent and Candy proved global world coordinates for general data in the critical space in dimensions 2 and 3, and they could obtain local world coordinates in the massive case in the critical space. The result I'm going to talk about today is the massive case in two dimensions, we proved global world coordinates in 7 for small initial data, even this one is small initial data. So somehow the picture is complete. Now maybe I should say that the difference about massless and massive. What is some of the thing? In a toy model, the massless cubic Dirac has this form. If you remember my listed equation with the conjugate, look at the time order. Essentially, you look at this equation, which is similar. It's a flavor of a wave map type equation. I should say that in the wave map equation, it's something similar, except that you don't have a derivative on every element. So, when I have this approach, what they did, they say, look, there were this is very structured level for the wave map equation, like the sound. And then we can apply them. Obviously, whenever you use those, you have to tailor them a little bit. But the fundamental problems that I'm going to talk about them here, or what are the problems that we improve to come with analytic structures to solve these problems, were in this paper. And they are able to get, of course, what you get in the Thanos theory, the best of type result. But then there's a fundamental problem for those familiar with the wave maps. Is the fact that you can get the best of type result and then there is a summation problem. And that's where you have all this series of paper by Tao, with the whole normalization of the whole problem. Now, that becomes a problem somehow if you're using this toy model. If you have a low frequency, medium frequency, so the derivative follows the medium and high frequency. If somehow the derivative would always follow the low frequency, it's somehow one of the heart of the normalization process in some sense, then you gain to do the best of type summation. Now what happens is that the cubic Dirac somehow is more fair to every component, so that gives you the room to get the summation. Now that's easier said than done, because in particular it took us quite a long time to figure this out in three dimensions, and what would have been done is actually they took that structure and with the ideas from the house paper, basically they were able to do the physical result. Now, what happens in the massive case? To fundamental problems. So starting with, you don't have clear resolution spaces. I'm going to make a point that these are at the heart of taking all the estimating, and what happens is that the wave equation picture is not applicable for the massive case. And also, there is an incomplete null structure. I'm going to say that there is a null structure, but it's incomplete into the equation, so this is why you can't really take this approach and attack the massive equation. Moreover, since we started the three-dimensional work on the cubic Dirac, we were actually motivated, okay, this was kind of a good vehicle for the theory we developed. But what we wanted to do was to take these kind of advanced theories that were present in the two-dimensional Schrodinger mass problem, the wave map problems, and try to see if this kind of replacement for the missing endpoints, the chance estimation, and to see if this can be done for other equations. So, okay, I kept saying them to an infinity, and then fixing, what is the basic idea of how do you want to solve this problem? It is a very basic iteration scheme of one. Simply, you want to say, look, if I get this type of estimate, I combine these two type estimates for the low frequencies, on the high frequency I'm going to put an energy type estimate, and here this is the perfect estimate you want to have on the right hand side. Now, why am I so greedy in asking this? I mean, we're talking about strict estimates when you have contaminants, you can put it that way. Because what happens is, over here, I have a half-wave type equation. In the wave equation, if you do not use energy type estimates, if you go to shoot for any other strict estimates, you're going to lose derivatives. Because this is the half of the equation, there is no mechanism to recover derivatives. So to close this game, you are forced to use energy here. The moment you use energy here and an energy space here, you are there is no other way but to get the lower frequencies in this extreme of 10.9. So there is no other way around this. So bottom line is that you've got to replicate something like this. And also, if you do like this, put it on the other side by calling, it's an infinity of things, you can somehow what you really do is an estimate of this type of cancel, an infinity times L infinity of time. You want to do the linear L2 time estimate. So this is somehow what we are after in all these lines. And now I get to linear estimates for free solutions. So this is what you see in the talk a few ago. Literally, it's exactly the same fundamental question. You take two bits, two initial data, you take the associated free evolution, they live on the Fourier side of these characteristic surfaces, product here becomes convolution. So, very simple question. Get an L2 type estimate. And it's always good to do this exercise. First, to understand a little bit the interactions and to see what should we expect from this problem. Now, what happens is that if for instance, if these two interactions, let's say that they are two different frequencies, and you do the interactions, what you notice is that you get good nice estimates when they have orthogonal support. So if the angles are separated, and then as the angle starts to close down, the estimates start to degenerate. Now this degeneracy, so it's hard for me to make a point, but you've seen it this morning, hidden in one of the slides. There was a convolution estimate, which, in two dimension, it flew up on a sphere. So the outer sphere, those kind of the resonance interactions, there was a degeneracy. So if you try to take the L to 1, you don't have a problem there. But for instance, that would have been a problem in dimensions 3 and higher, if you remember the concept. So really, it's the same picture, more or less. Now, one of the things is that, in the Klein-Gordon, somehow the characteristic surfaces of the separated frequencies, they always make an angle. So unlike, for instance, in a wave equation where separate frequencies, if they are parallel, the characteristic surfaces would be parallel to each other, here there is always a little bit of room, so somehow there is a backstop into the degeneracy that happens here. So what I'm trying to say is that if you think that how can you get a picture, so for example, you know, so the idea is that at the origin you look kind of like a parabola and asymptotically you start looking like a cone, but this slope never gets to be one, so there is always, even between parallel interactions, there is an angle between the characteristic surfaces. So that's something that somehow puts a nice topic to be. Now, if you somehow inject some null structure into the equation, and if you remember on the other side, there was some null form estimates, that like on one of the titles of the slide, this is what you're trying to do, then you start improving these coefficients. Bottom line, this is what you like to replicate in the theory. That's what you see, but there's a fundamental problem. You take free solutions, you do this iteration, and you do this estimates, and that gives you the result for the first iteration in the problem. When you go to the second iteration, you don't have free solutions, you don't have this beautiful approximations. You have solutions that solve the problem, they have more complicated structure. There is no way to replicate it unless you go into these Boolean-type spaces. But in that case, you basically would have to assume too strong of a structure on your solutions, and that always creates logarithmic divergences. So this is, for instance, the head result is really an excellent type result, but you can get a critical because you somehow must be able to leak feature all over. So now, the way to go around this is, we need to come with estimates that would replicate this type of behavior, but more robust for solutions, not only for free solutions, but for solutions to inhomogeneous equations as well. Now, one thing you should tell you see in a moment, or you've seen it already in the symbol of the operator, in low frequency, the equation, the Klein-Gordon, is Schrodinger-like. In high frequency, it is wave-like. So, and the question that you want to address is, do I have such an estimate? I copy the data in L2, do I end up in an L2 at infinity space, and then, you know, the scaling should tell you how much of your life you should spend in that direction. Now, in three dimensions, the scaling indicates S equal 1. In two dimensions, it indicates S equal half. And then you say, okay, so is the estimate true? Then the answer is, in three dimensions, the estimate fails logarithmically. So it fails, like very little. In two dimensions, so it holds you to lose a little bit of derivatives in addition to what the scaling would tell you. In two dimensions, it fails completely, because in particular, it's not even true for the Schrodinger equation. So you have to give up. And also, I should point out the important aspect here. So, in Klein-Gordon, if you do not care about optimal type results, you can always be wasteful, give up derivatives in the problem, and make it behave as if it were a Schrodinger equation. You can always play that game. And then it will give you somehow forcefully access the whole class of more robust estimates coming from the from the Schrodinger equation. But that would obviously have to pay a price for now. That means you lose way too much in the optimality of the result. So this is why, in some sense, you are always going to keep in mind that in high frequency, this is a wave-type equation. So, going back to these estimates, how do you think about it? How do I want to get such type of estimates? Let's say I have a data, right? And I flow it, and I'm asking, okay, do I have such an estimate? We all know it by now. This is that's the scaling that tells you what you should expect for that constant. But this is kind of argument, particularly fast type argument. And essentially, it all boils down to take the kernel and try to understand sort of what do you look like, frequency t, and then you integrate essentially this is a recommendation, but what you should think is morally that you have what the characteristic surface. So here always a frequency t, either the measure supported at frequency t on the parabolic low frequencies, product at high frequencies, you take the Fourier transform and you want to get an estimate of this type, and that will guarantee that you have an estimate of this type. And that hinges on good decay estimates on this kernel. And how do you obtain that? Classical oscillatory phase type arguments. What somehow tells you what is the fundamental driving force for that are the principal curvatures of the time phase distance. And that is tau equals square root x squared plus 1. And this is why I keep saying that in the low frequency, so when c is small, it is a parabolic high surface. It's got good curvature in polarization. Move what c is very high, you're already moving into some wave regime. Right? So, and I make more. So, for low frequencies, Schrödinger gives you, okay, minus n over 2. And the L2 L infinity type estimate is architected by the Schrödinger equation, and it is known all okay with the grain of salt. Very easy in two dimensions, H6. Check it out, let me not get into that. I think that is a block post from the Schrödinger maps theory. So I know how to deal with that. The focus here is what you do with high frequencies. So in high frequencies, the characteristic surface is cone-like, yet it has non-vanishing curvature. What do I mean about that? It's cone-like in somehow the radial direction. What cone-like means it has a degenerated curvature. 2 to the minus 2 case. So it's getting very close to 0, but it's not 0, and then you have good curvature in the angular directions. So, well, not very pretty estimate, but this is it. That's not what you want to stare at because it's not easy. But I just, what I'm telling you is that you have two time decay regimes. For time series, up to the size of the frequencies, you are in a wave type regime. Once you pass that, you enter a Schrödinger time regime. Okay? So you can do anything about it. Then I get this type of estimation, but the answer is no. I mean, my point is, you have these very good estimates. You try to estimate this in L1D and infinity. In 2D, you get logarithmic divergence. In 2D, it gets even worse. So, and the idea was, well, okay, so maybe it's too much to ask for these estimates to hold true in the classical coordinates, Cx. Maybe we can do something better. So, for instance, getting back to the massless problem, that will fix in a very, very nice way, in a way that you would think, and I mean, for all good reasons, that's the worst problem. Because what you have is a cone type characteristic surface. You have embedded zero curvature manifold, so somehow you lose the whole dimension that is trade off already the whole degree of decay. But there is a very nice property. You can fully the cone precisely. And some of the whole idea is that here what you have is F delta line, which is F in L2, and then you say, well, when you go on the physical side, they are going to be constant along these lines, so if you request the system to be L2, L infinity over this, you basically foliate the whole solution into continuous foliation of waves that in their adapted coordinates will recompute the L2 infinity estimates. The problem that we encounter here is we do not have the zero curvature, we have non-vanishing curvature, it's a generated part.